What am I good at? I can shred on the drums, and I'm a marketing whiz.
All right, welcome back to Reel It In. Today we are with Rabah Rahil, the CMO at Triple Whale, the platform that is centralizing all your metrics from all your tools right in your pocket to give you a clearer picture of your digital performance. Rabah, thanks so much for joining us today. We're excited to talk to you about all things KPIs, metrics, digital performance, Triple Whale, to help D2C brands kind of navigate this tricky world right now. So yeah, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, absolutely, guys. Thanks for having me on. And I thought the preamble was almost half the podcast. It was great. It was just fun to just kind of shoot the shit with you guys.
Yeah, no, it was great. Yeah,
in the green room.
Great chatting with you. We talked a little bit about D2C after dark. Let's just start with that a little bit because it's super interesting. I think as far as like in my marketing world, when I'm looking online at cool shit to potentially like copy or what I think is a fun idea, D2C after dark really stood out. So I guess what was it? What is it? And like what was the inspiration behind it?
Yeah, so AJ and Max are really amazing bosses that they give me a ton of leeway to build a really cool brand for them. And so they are also very receptive to really out of the box ideas. And so every quarter or so, I try and do what we call like moonshot marketing, where it'll just be this wacky idea. There's really no direct line to revenue. Ultimately, it's just like, hey, let's see where this lands, get some budgets together, possibly some sponsorships to subsidize it a little bit so the company doesn't have to eat all of it. And let's try it out. So one of them was D2C After Dark. This was a riff off of basically like MTV Real World. So I was like, we talked offline, I'm 37. So like I grew up in the 90s when MTV was like peak MTV, where it was just crazy awesomeness. And so we basically flew out six D2C creators. So we had a contest, people submitted their UGC to get picked. We picked six UGC creators. We put them up in 11,000 square foot penthouse right in the middle of Austin, Texas. It was absolutely stunning. The penthouse was amazing. And then we just had a bunch of activities with the film crew following them. So we had one of the things that we did was we rented a big old yacht on Lake Travis. It's a big lake here out in Austin. So we're just boating out for the day. Vacation Inc. was one of our sponsors. So people are using sunscreen. And so that was kind of I kind of buried the lead. The whole point was we have obviously over 5,000 merchants now. So we reached out to all of our Triple Whalers and said, hey, we're doing this event. Do you guys want to either sponsor it or have some product placement and go ahead and send us some product and we'll get you in the show? And so we had over 75 brands send product, really big brands, Huron, all sorts of really amazing people, Wink Wine, just really, really cool brands, send all this product. And then we basically just stocked the fridges and all the creators got these swag bags. And so not only were the creators there to obviously, you know, make the reality show, but they were also requested to make 10 to 16 pieces of UGC for the actual client. So that was kind of the direct line of like, hey, AJ Max, I'm getting you X amount of videos for our client. So that was kind of the primary selling point. And then secondary and tertiary were more so brand awareness. So we did the yacht thing. We sent them to a fancy dinner. We put got a table at a really cool spot called Devil May Care to kind of do the night out thing. And then we went and it was pretty cool. We got a big party bus and wrapped it in a bunch of Triple Whale swag. So we had this big Triple Whale bus just cruising around Austin. It was really cool. We went up to Congress, there's like cool little sights to see in Austin with like murals and stuff. So we got to go to all of those. And then that night we brought in, I'm really good friends with an incredible chef, and he catered a whole dinner at the penthouse, which is really, it was like the best meal I've ever had. So yeah, that was all of it. And so the deliverables would be 4 to 5 episodes around 10 to 20 minutes long each episode with a bunch of product placement. But ultimately it's going to be, yeah, just a riff off a reality TV show. That'll be a bunch of product placement and a bunch of UGC creators just kind of chopping it up, talking about life, everything, creating all this stuff. So yeah, basically like a real world knockoff or for people across the pond, the Big Brother, that kind of thing. We're a little voyeuristic, but yeah, it was cool. It was a really big lift, like I was saying. It was not something I would definitely recommend or take as lightly as I did. It was a big, big lift. And shout out to Alexa and Kevin, who I couldn't have done it without them. But yeah, it was awesome. Got a bunch of really cool brands, like I said. And our HQ is just like this D2C paradise with just all the name brands you can think of in D2C just sending us stuff. So it was really cool to see that. And it was, you know, in a way, I don't try and get into ego stuff, but it was a nice pump up. Like all these other brands, like we were barely a year old, and all these huge, like aspirational brands for me personally are like wanting to hang out with us in the metaphorical sense of like, hey, we want to be aligned with you. Here's product. Can you show us this product and stuff? So it was also a really cool barometer check in terms of where we're at in the market. So net net, it was really awesome. Tons of drama, tons of craziness. Like we were talking offline, we'll probably end up doing like a D2C After Dark Unplugged or something where we'll bring in all the cast members and do like a recap of everything, watch the footage together and stuff. Cause there was just, there is always something, put it that way. Like when you get into leadership positions, yeah. Like I do not envy AJ. I do want to run my own like ship eventually, but like I'm just the CMO, so I only have to deal with the marketing silo. And so like AJ and Max dealing with just everything, I don't know how they do it because I'm stressed to the gills. So net, it was great though. Really fun. We should have some B-roll and stuff kind of trickling out in the next week or two, and then it'll probably take us 30 days or so to fully produce all the episodes, and then we'll probably have like a screening party and stuff. So there's more stuff to come, but it was a labor of love to say the least.
Yeah, you can have Andy Cohen do the reunion show.
There we go, right? Yeah, MC it.
There we go. What was one thing that you learned? Yeah, what was one thing that you learned through that process about UGC content creation that maybe you didn't know before?
I didn't realize how, like, honestly, these people were like, I don't want to say mini because it sounds like a pejorative, but like mini producers. Like they saw the shots. Like I thought it was more freestyling. Like people would just, Parker pulls out his camera. Hey, I like X, Y, or Z because of this. It's literally changed my life. Like there was so much sophistication to these shots that these people were doing. And then they would stitch it all up. And that was also another thing. Like these people are absolutely surgical with an iPhone. They can not only shoot on it, but they can edit on it. They can do all these things. And they just make these miraculous things where I come from more of a traditional background where you shoot it and then you put it into Final Cut or some Adobe software, Premiere, and then you cut it up. And then, like, none of that. It was like calf to cow, shoot it, cut it, do this, throw some transitions on there. So it was really impressive to see how, in terms of just film and cinematography, advanced all these people were. I guess I didn't have that respect for them, but it was just really impressive to see in person how much these people could do with the cell phone. And then the final products were just really, really incredible. I always knew they were great storytellers, but they really have a cinematographer bent that I didn't recognize or appreciate before I saw them kind of in their environment doing the work. It was really cool to see how they saw the same place that I did, but in different lenses, different angles. Oh, I can do this and that. It was really interesting.
Yeah, we were recently, Tom and I were speaking with
go ahead, Park. Let's go ahead and get into that.
Yeah, can you guys hear me? Oh, yeah, I think there's a massive, yeah, there's a big delay. Okay, cool. Yeah, so you mentioned that reset. Yeah, you mentioned that the D2C After Dark was like more of a moonshot, no direct line of revenue type of promotion there. Let's talk about probably the most direct line to revenue, which is going to be like your paid ads, right? And let's get this one out of the way early because I'm sure you're sick of talking about it. Okay. But like iOS 14.5, all that stuff, it's becoming a lot harder to track attribution and, you know, make sure you're spending your money in the wisest way possible. How have you seen it affecting marketers' decision-making, and what is Triple Whale doing to help fix that?
Yeah, it's a great question. It's really tough out there on the streets right now, but there are some things that you can do to kind of mitigate some of the destruction that Apple has caused with their dot updates. I've kind of said this on a few other podcasts, so I don't want to sound like a broken record, but it's really the three things that I've seen is people that are really leaning into community. So that sounds like super cheesy, super cliche, but people that are really leaning into community, not only can it build a great moat, it can be really awesome in terms of product research. And third, it can really augment and kind of help mitigate some of the CX issues that you can kind of see. So people that have a really strong community that are building that community have been really, really helpful. People that are diversifying their spend. So we're actually going to drop some data here pretty soon, but like Pinterest, TikTok, they're exploding. I mean, they're still like babies, right, in the game in comparison to the Menlo Monster, Facebook, and then Google. Their orders of magnitude lower in spend, but in terms of actual percent changes from basically Q1 to Q2 of this year versus Q3 of Q4, they've exploded, which is even crazier because Q3 and Q4 are like always the biggest spending, most expensive times to buy ads. And so to surpass that in Q1 and Q2, there's an absolute trend shift there. So people are definitely that people that have figured out how to diversify their spends away from Facebook have absolutely been able to see growth. And that doesn't necessarily mean paid platforms. So influencers have been either micro, macro, however, have been really big boons to people as well. So I think there's been a healthy, like, obviously you don't want to see people losing their jobs or businesses kind of going under, but there has been a creative destruction in a way, a reset of the market where marketers have to get better, where there was just this bull run in terms of Facebook ads were so underpriced and you could target so precisely that I think a lot of marketers got lazy. And at the end of the day, the way I see marketing, and maybe it's because I'm in a leadership role, but even when I was buying ads, it was the same thing where I just see it as an allocation of capital or a deployment of capital. Like, what's the most efficient way I can acquire customers? If that's buying effing billboards, buy the billboards. If that's newspaper ads, buy the newspaper ads. And there's just kind of this, I think, dogma or stigma in terms of, oh, I only have to be on Google and Facebook because that's what everybody else does. And it's like, maybe, but maybe your business is different. Like, we have businesses going 50, 60, 70 million built strictly off influencers. They're just starting paid. And so I think there's a healthy shift back to like, okay, cool, how should I allocate my capital? Maybe it is buying on Facebook and Google, but maybe I should test these other channels. And so that's kind of to round out the answer is what Triple Whale can help you do is you can see all these camera systems and they're all interlinked through the triple pixel. And then you can see, are my influencers making money? Is my email actually pushing forward stuff? Or maybe it is my Facebook, or maybe it is my Google or TikTok or Pinterest or something like that. And so you can allocate that capital a lot easier, more effectively and efficiently. And so that's kind of the three things that we've seen. Kind of to recap was diversification and spend. Oh, I forgot the third one. Diversification and spend, community, and then foundational economics. So there's a saying in health where you can't out-train a bad diet. I believe the same thing exists for marketing where you can't out-buy bad economics. I don't care how good of a marketer you are, the fundamentals of the economics are going to catch up to you. So if you have low margin products, if you have really terrible shipping rates or pick and pack rates, like you're going to just start eating in the contribution margin. And at the end of the day, like personally, I think revenue, especially now that like the day of the exits are kind of sunsetting, like revenue is just a vanity metric. Like it doesn't really matter. Like you can have all this top line revenue. And then if you have this just terrible operational costs, you're just going to basically, so too long didn't read. I had a client a couple years ago when I was running my agency that had cleared $1 million, which is like, you know, that's not a bunch of money, but it's not a little money. He cleared $1 million in his business in top line, and he was negative $22,000 in net profit. Like, that ain't the path to make $1 million and have to pay back negative $22,000. And so that, I think, is kind of where people are running away from, where they're starting to not growth at all costs anymore, but more profitable growth. Like, if I can grow a little less but keep more of my profit, that's a better situation to be in. And I guess it's not everybody, but mostly the D2C. Like, most D2C brands aren't really out there to exit. You know, maybe some are, so that might be different, where you want to have a story and the growth and et cetera, and then you get paid off even though you're not profitable. But the people that are like mom and pops or people that had a product that just grew, you know, from $10,000 to $1 million to $40 million, they need to figure out how they can keep more of their money versus just growing at diminishing returns. So yeah, in recap, I would say the three things that we see is community, foundational economics, and diversification of spend. And then obviously the triple pixel can help you in terms of understanding the efficacy of the spend you're deploying.
Let's go a little deeper on that. So in reading like the TJ Maxx like founding story here, sorry, it's AJ, right?
AJ. TJ?
Yeah.
I thought you were talking about the discount store for a second. I was like, I don't know this story.
I know, and when I said it didn't feel right. Exactly. but let's talk about like how this all came about. So initially it seemed like most of their language is around like aggregating all these data sources in one like easy to reference spot. But then it seemed like with these iOS updates, the triple pixel became like very core to the overall like value proposition, in the sense that it would actually give marketers a full picture beyond just last click attribution that they were no longer able to easily get. So like, talk to us about how that all came about, and maybe when you realized that you were sitting on a gold mine with this.
Yeah, I mean, that's all credit to AJ and Max. They're really visionaries. So they built this product, actually, like most awesome products, was dog fooded. So AJ was actually running, Max has a hair braids company with his wife, and he was running this company, and he hired AJ to do his marketing. Mm-hmm. And then basically every spreadsheet that Max had, AJ was like, oh, we should build an app for this. We should build an app for this. And so all of this came about. We were doing okay, but then to your point, once we built the triple pixel, that was a real big inflection point to really get not only into the attribution game, but ultimately we had all the other parts, but the attribution is just such an easy on-ramp, and it's also really easy sell to leadership, where it's like, I need to track my stuff. Oh, and by the way, I get all this other stuff. So quite frankly, people were not buying a dashboard. They didn't want another dashboard. But when you got them, it was almost like come for the attribution, stay for the customer insights and the summary page. And so it was a really, I wouldn't say a loss leader because it's a big value generation feature for us, but it was this door opener, if you will, that we could kind of wedge ourselves in.
Yeah.
And then, oh, by the way, we have all this other amazing things to understand how your business, profit tracking, all these things that help understand how your business is doing at its core, but then you also can understand the effectiveness and efficacy of your ads. Because I'm huge on attribution, but at the same time, there's a certain aspect of one, it's never going to be 100%. It's kind of like there's something called an asymptote, where it's like two lines that get infinitely close to each other but never touch. That's kind of what attribution is going to be. It's never going to be 100%. And there's also some things that sometimes knowing your customer preferences, understanding your economics, understanding these other things of your business can be more important and foundational than knowing how well your ads are doing. So you can look at these macro heuristics. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of this nice mesh of like, you can know what your ads are doing as well, and you can know how your business is doing. And so I think that marriage has been really interesting. And then we have a finance hub coming. We have an influencer module coming. We just launched a creative cockpit, which is an upgrade of our creative dashboard. And so we're building out almost this modular system where you can pick and choose what you think is best for your business. And that way you only pay for the things that are going to generate value for you. So it's been a really nice transition in that sense of going from a dashboard to more of this holistic system that you can almost like buying a car. If you want leather seats, or if you want the supercharged engine, or if you want the moonroof or whatever, you can get it. Or if you don't need it and you're just, you know, a business under just starting under $1 million or something like that, you can just get X, Y, and Z basics to get you the car that goes from A to Z that's economical.
Yeah. The creator cockpit is something that's near and dear to our data-driven hearts over here. Something that we're constantly encouraging our clients to do is, you know, do more testing, think about channel-specific content strategies, and start to understand what's working best, right? What we always talk about is this premise of, like, you can come to the room with a certain opinion of what you think is going to perform best, but ultimately, like, the loudest voice in the room has to be the data.
I love that line.
So, yeah, well, actually, I'll have you react to this. This is something that we like to say all the time. In 5 years, there won't be a single content decision that isn't made heavily informed by data. Where does your mind go when you hear that?
I think the best people will adhere to that. I think there's a lot of people that think they're better than data, and like, I think those people are bad.
Oh, yeah.
Well, not bad, but like, that was kind of, there's a great line by Bezos that he said, like, if you come to me and argue with me, I'm always right. But if you argue with me with data, then I'll talk to you. And so I'm paraphrasing a bit, but it's essentially that. Because I'm the boss, I'm always going to be right. But if you show me data, then I'll change my mind. So I do think there's something to that. I think my big thesis for the next 3 to 5 years is that the media buyer itself is going to get abstracted away. So you're seeing this a little bit right now with Google Max, Performance Max, where you basically, these channels, I think, are going to just turn into black boxes of like, give me creative and give me money and I'll figure it out. And so the days of like day trading and having these incredibly complex campaign structures and all this nonsense of 78 ad sets and all this stuff, I think those are actually going away. So I think there's going to be some challenges for people that lived in the areas of just tweaking knobs to make these little like percent changes. But I think there's also going to be a ton of value in kind of what you guys are talking about, in understanding how to derive insights and pattern recognition of like, oh, this angle is working really well, or this is a really good hook for us, or we should lean into X, Y, and Z. And the people that build those systems around, like you said, the data, I think those are people that are going to really prosper. And I, personally, too, it's a better way to live. Yeah. Like if you live on performance, it's a really hard life because it's you're just lucky, essentially. Whereas if you can build a scientific framework behind, like a thesis-driven framework of like, here's the hypothesis, here's what I expect to happen, here's what happened, do a postmortem, and then just keep running that loop. Because in that way, you're never wrong. You're just either getting learnings or you're succeeding. But when you're just always looking like, the worst thing is when somebody, oh, can you, I want to go viral or something like that. I was like, what does that even mean, dude? Like, do you or do you want more money? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I can get you a viral post on TikTok, but what if nobody buys it? Who cares? So it kind of gets into, for me, like, it's a bit of analogous to, like, the CPM game. It's like, unless you really are just buying for reach, it's like, what do you care what the CPMs are? Like, who cares if you can be in the room with the richest people that are going to have the biggest wallets that are absolutely going to buy? Why don't you want to pay 2 or 3x to get in front of those people versus being in front of the poppers that have no money and that are just kicking the tires? Like, who cares? And so I think it can be a lack of clarity in terms of what the goal is. And I think making sure you know what that goal is and then working your back from there, what the data supports and what's actually moving you towards that goal is really important. So I semi-agree with what you're saying, but I do think there's going to be some people that are really charismatic that will always – I think the people experience the world through stories, and there's really good storytellers that will pervert what the data is saying.
Basically – twist it to align what with their narrative what is. They think.
Yeah, exactly. And there's no judgment on that. It is what it is.
You're so, right. You're so close to, you know, all these hundreds and thousands of D2C brands. Looking into the next like 2-3 years, what else do you think the sort of winners, the outlier performers are going to do better than their counterparts?
I think the winners are going to, and you're kind of seeing, they're not a client, but I follow them. Like Ridge Wallets, and I think what people are finding is they're trying to change the business model that got them there. The business model that got them to A is not going to be the business model that gets them to B. And so the people that can either change the economics, whether that be through getting better shipping rates, whether that be to shrinking their cash conversion cycle, whether that be to literally changing their business model in terms of product expansion. So like, for example, like Ridge Wallet, you buy a wallet once, you know what I mean? You're not going to buy 58 wallets or something like that. And so you're starting to see them expand their product line. So now, because ultimately, like, customer value manifests in two ways, AOV or LTV. And so if you're an AOV business, you need to figure out, hey, how can I either, one, increase that AOV, but then it gets challenging because usually if you increase AOV, acquisition costs go up because you need more touch points to have somebody, instead of buying a $100 thing, you want them to buy a $1,000 thing. It's a totally different customer journey. It's a totally different story. And so you can either do that, or you can, hey, here's some other, like, you know, periphery add-ons to the core business that you can then start to, and now you get into this really nice area where if you have a community, you have those nice those nice economics, and then you have that diversification of spend. I think that's what you're going to see the winners do, is change their business models essentially through, again, whether that lever is economics or different product lines or expansion of that sort.
It's really interesting. Park, do you want to go zoom out real quick?
Yeah, let's zoom out. I think where I'd like to take this is, we kind of already touched on it a little bit too, is like, there is always that balance between data and intuition, right? And the quantitative data versus the qualitative data. Is there any, like, are there any, in your mind, qualitative data points that marketers should be focusing on that, like, for example, Triple Whale just cannot provide them with? And how do you balance that with, like, what the data is telling you to do? Because as you said, like, a lot of marketers in their gut feel like they're right and want to go down a certain path. I think... I think our listeners would really get value out of figuring out just like what qualitative data points should you focus on and which ones should you ignore?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good question. I think ultimately, I like qualitative data points, but I think, again, they're more susceptible to narrative building and quantitative, where it's like, here's literally what's happening, where qualitative is more directional stuff. So I think the macro things of, so we have a thesis called Three ROAS to Rule Them All, and it's a mix of almost qualitative, quantitative, where it's more on the quantitative side. But basically, as a media buyer, you need to care about three things: efficiency, effectiveness, and profits. And so we've built these three heuristics where ultimately the ecosystem ROAS or MRR or blended ROAS, whatever you want to call it, just total sales over total ad spend, that's going to be your effectiveness heuristic. How effective are your ads? Efficiency is going to be new customer ROAS. And so it's going to be your new customer revenue divided by total ad spend. That's going to be your efficiency metric. And again, these are all channel agnostic. So this is money in, money out type of stuff. And then the last thing is going to be your POAS. It's essentially your contribution margin. So it's going to be your gross profit divided by your total ad spend. And so those are the three things that I always look at when I was running my agency. These were what I was looking at for all the clients, because not only are they like real, it gives you kind of that directionality, like what's the health of my business, and then how effective, efficient, and profitable are my ads. And so those are kind of the three big ones in terms of qualitative stuff. So like there's some post-purchase survey stuff that we build in, but ultimately I'm not a huge qualitative guy. Just again, not that you shouldn't, I like to think of it like a murder scene. And so the more witnesses you have, and then you can synthesize those data points around that where you can kind of make your own independent decision on top of those. I just don't weight qualitative stuff as highly just because it is not as close to the numbers per se, but I know it's kind of like a roundabout in the weeds answer, but that's kind of where I land.
No, I'd agree with you. I think there's also like a lot of bias that goes into it too. You tend to believe the narrative you want to be true. I do it constantly, but don't tell Tom. So I guess comparing business, Triple Whale, I'm sure works with like businesses of various sizes. So depending on like what stage of where your business is, are there different things you should be focused on from like as far as paid metrics, paid KPIs go? For example, like if you're doing 1,000 orders a month versus a company that's doing like 10,000 orders a month, like are there any like metrics you can call out that might be more important for that smaller brand to focus on?
Yeah, definitely. So the smaller brand stuff is just making sure you're pushing product out, making sure you're either breaking even on your first purchase with your AOV, or I mean, honestly, that's even more important depending on how old your brand is, because you can get into a lot of fuckery with LTV extrapolations, especially if your brand is really young, you know, under a year kind of stuff, where you just haven't had a while to mature and see what these cohorts are going to produce in terms of LTV. So I would say definitely concentrate on AOV and understanding how you can generate the most revenue on those first acquisitions. LTV is going to definitely be important, but as your business matures, you can get more insight into that. So I would really concentrate, honestly, on new customer ROAS would be something that would be really top of mind for me. So how much money am I bringing in on these new customers? And then as my business progresses and matures, then you can really start to kick in your retention. So making sure you're watching that customer mix, where at the beginning, you're probably going to have more new customers than old returning customers. But then you should see that flip where you're 60-40 kind of in returning to new, or 70-30, where there should be some built-in retention. Again, this is going to be contextual in the business model. Like if you're modern fuel or something and you're selling a pen made of, you know, jet steel or something, you're only going to buy one of those. It's not. So that's a different story. The other thing I would say is as you get bigger, the boring stuff becomes more important. And so what I mean by that, like I've seen kind of, it's weird. It's like this 10 million a year run rate mark, where you kind of have to start to mature. You can't really be a mom and pop business anymore. You really have to understand cash flow. You really have to understand your cash conversion cycle. You really have to understand what your terms are with your shippers. Warehousing can be an issue. Distribution can be an issue. There gets these kind of, again, just kind of more boring stuff where as you approach that $10 million above, you really need to hone in on your finances, and whether that be getting somebody out of house to help you with that or bringing somebody in house to help you with that. That's the biggest mistakes I see, is people just keep growing like, you know, the Wild West. And then they just get into some weird financial quagmires because they just don't understand how things work. And it's not that big of a deal when you're small, because it's just crazy. Like, get product out, get product in people's hands, build a brand that people love. Like, there's all these kind of things that matter. And then once that's established, you really need to understand your finances and economics. And I keep harping on that because it just really is, like, you can have an incredible brand be scuttled by bad finances. And so you can hire a bunch of people that, like, you don't need. And so now you have this crazy burn rate that your business can't support. And now you are out of stock, or you're two top sellers. And now you're in this weird cash flow discrepancy where it's like, how do I pay my employees? Oh my God, I never had this issue when it was just me and mom selling tea. You know what I'm saying? And so there's a certain aspect. But the bright side to that is, when you start getting to that size, you can also concentrate on things like conversion rate and optimization in that sense. And a 0.5% bump for somebody doing 100 orders a month is a nothing burger. A 0.5% bump for somebody doing 10,000 orders a month is real money. And so there's different levers that you pull on at different scales. And so that's kind of what I would say. When you're small, you really need to stay scrappy and just get it done, you know, pound the pavement, guerrilla marketing, sell, sell, sell. And then as you approach kind of that 10, I don't know why 10 million, but it's just what I've encountered, where people can just fall apart or really scale. And so then you get to a point where you really need to be judicious in terms of your finances, understanding the economics of your business, understanding how the cash flows through the business and then how it materializes. And so you just have to kind of level up, kind of grow up in a way, and your business just gets more complex as it scales.
Yeah, I think it always comes down to understanding the dollars and cents of it all. And the financial literacy aspect of it is super important. I think when people start businesses, a lot of times, especially marketers, it's like, you know, the least of their concerns. And then once you get to that point, it's, you know, the roof starts caving in and you got to figure it out. Cool. We're coming up on time here. So Tom, do you have any last questions you want to ask Rabah before we wrap it up? Or are you all good?
God, there's almost too many. What does the next year look like for Triple Whale? You've hinted at new modules and coming up with new ways to build value for existing clients, but how would you articulate it?
Yeah, I mean, ultimately we want to be the e-commerce operating system. And so we want to be synonymous with Shopify. So you spin up a Shopify store and then you get Triple Whale in whatever fashion that makes sense for your business is kind of the macro goal. And then the way we enable that is through just launching a cool bunch of cool modules. Like I said, we have a finance module coming, which is really awesome. Kind of going back to some of these points of like helping people understand their cash position, their cash flow, things of that nature that are like super nerdy. And quite frankly, they don't matter really that much at the beginning. That's what the weird kind of paradox is of all this. Like, if you do all this stuff at the beginning, it doesn't matter if your business doesn't succeed. And so it's like you need to concentrate on building this machine that can actually succeed, and then you can figure out how to like layer on this sophistication. And so I think that's kind of the chicken and egg issue with this is like it's important, but it's not important at the beginning. Like, obviously you want to start with good economics, but at the end of the day, you just got to move product at the beginning. Get your first 10 customers, get your first 100 customers, get your first 1,000. Anywho, so that is going to be really cool. We have some inventory tracking coming, which is going to be really awesome. So supply and demand matching is a huge issue for D2C, like we were talking about cash flow stuff, where if you run out of stock for 2 or 3 weeks or two or three of your top selling products, a lot of D2C brands also, you know, might only have 3 to 5 flagship SKUs anyway. So if you lose your top players, you're basically dead in the water for 2 to 3 months. On top of, you pretty much scuttle all your paid acquisition because you want to run ads behind terrible, well, not terrible products, but, you know, C squad products that people aren't buying for a reason. So that demand inventory or demand supply matching is going to be really cool. We have an influencer management coming. And then we just have a bunch of cool, like, fun events. So we're going to be throwing a pickleball tournament. There's a really cool company out here called Recess. So we're getting some custom Triple Whale paddles, and we're going to sponsor a big pickleball tournament out here in Austin. We have the Whaleys coming up in January, where it's going to be 2 days of education and then a D2C awards show. We're throwing out here in Austin. You guys should come out. It's going to be a banger. So I'm really excited for that. We have a big event with Air Inc., the cloud provider, where we're going to do an event with them on the Creative Cockpit. We just finished our podcast studio, so we'll be cranking out a bunch of content there. today we're finishing wrapping Triple Well University, which would be about 25 videos that we'll just keep adding to of this core curriculum of understanding how to use Triple Well, how to run your business, macroeconomics, microeconomics, financial stuff. So pretty excited about that. So we have a ton coming, but ultimately the too long didn't read is becoming that default, like, we want to be omnipresent. That was the big shift in our acquisition strategy. Is I ran this at the beginning like a D2C company, where it really needs to be more so like a CPG company, where we want to be omnipresent and really obviously want to get in front of people that can buy, but we just want to be omnipresent whale. Where it was funny, we had a story where a client was taking a package to FedEx, and the FedEx guy had heard of us. So that's kind of like the aspirational kind of thing, where it's like, this FedEx guy isn't starting a Shopify store, but if he does, then he'll know he should get Triple Well. And so that is kind of the big overarching view. And then you have this nice top of funnel, and then we have just a world-class sales team on top of a ton of touchless conversions as well. So there's this nice bifurcation in terms of sales. So it's kind of a long-winded answer, but a lot's coming.
Yeah, action-packed. If they ever do.
Yeah. Perfect. And where
can you... Oh, I was just going to say, if they ever do Triple Whale Bachelor, I'm available to hand out some roses if we want to expand on the After Dark situation.
We'll see how it goes. You'll be first in line, Parker. That's amazing.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah, so we'll link to your Twitter below, but is there anywhere else our listeners should, you know, be able to reach you, or anything else you want to plug right now?
Yeah, the Twitters is great. We are also, so triplewell.com, if you want to get more involved with Triple Well, you can sign up there. And then we have an amazing newsletter that goes out every Tuesday, Thursday called Well Mail. You can subscribe right on our Twitter bio at Triple Well.
Awesome, yeah. Subscribe there. Check them out. Rabah, thanks so much for your time. For our listeners, we'll catch you later on Reel It In.